Hey guys, what is up? This is the first introduction I have done for the series. And this is the first of the series. This is going to be, I think, for now, Comic Collision.
I like it. I'll take it.
And to start things off with a bang, because it's Thanksgiving and a lot of amazing comics come out, but we're not going to talk about them because it's Thanksgiving. We have other stuff to do, sadly.
Indeed.
So this will be the first issue, if you will, of in the first fight, Miller versus Moore.
Frank Miller in this corner, 6 foot something. Skinny as a rail, kind of went crazy after 9/11.
And more than
in
kinda.
The other corner,
Alan Moore, even taller. most of that is probably his beard, though, as long as most of his newly formed weight, I'm going to guess.
Right.
Yeah, this is the magician versus Mr. Beer, Mr. Booze, Broads, and Bullets, basically.
Yes!
And, okay, I had this idea a while ago, just for the fact that we were talking about a few creatives, and it dawned on me just how freaking similar and different these two guys are at the exact same time. This is Alan Moore being the guy who took the superheroes to a very dark, dark, gritty place, along the same time Frank Miller was taking them to a very dark, gritty place. Yet somehow the dark and gritty places were completely different towns and completely different universes.
As they said in Pulp Fiction, it's not the same ballpark, it's not the same league, it's not even the same fucking sport.
Yeah, very much so. So, and these are two men that, to be honest, we owe so much to in the comics industry today.
It's right.
Naughty, like, to look at the movies nowadays, if people don't give respect to Miller and Moore, they're crazy because the movies right now are taking so much inspiration from the work that they set up.
And for better or for worse,
yeah,
I'm going to actually crib pretty heavily from something that Jeff Lesher said on a recent podcast that I listened to, the Wait What podcast. He mentioned, and this is entirely true, what Frank Miller did was so cool that Jim Lee couldn't help but ape it and pay homage to it in his own Batman work. And then what Jim Lee did was so cool that the newer artists and the creators can't help but pay homage to it in their work. So it doesn't matter what you're reading, you're always going to get a scene where Batman punches a cop.
Yes, that is something I'm sure we'll get into very quickly with these two, both these guys. Almost their biggest critique is what others in their footsteps have done.
Right, exactly.
Although, in their fairness, to break it down, how we can do this, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 fights, and we can kind of talk about 5 major points for both these guys. Kind of talk about it. Yes, 5 rounds in this, if you will. And we'll see who comes out on the winning side. And I wanted to start things. Most wars start very small and end with a nuclear bomb or some giant thing. I wanted to do that in reverse. I wanted to start with the nuclear bomb and see what was left in the fallout. And I wanted to compare these men's. This is weird, just saying it's both of their greatest works and what they're most known for. So I want to start this fight off with the ballsiest move ever, Dark Knight Returns versus Watchmen.
Wow. That's insane, my friend.
Yes, but.
Both are, as pretty much anyone who would be listening to this podcast would know, the cornerstones of influential work on the comics and graphic novel industry.
When we talked about earlier in the introduction, we're not joking. We're especially these books; their ramifications are still felt so much. It is not funny. I mean, Batman vs Superman. It is the Dark Knight Returns Batman at this point.
Right.
And every single movie of a team post-Watchmen has taken some kind of inspiration from Watchmen on whether they wanted to follow that serious look or wanted to go the complete opposite. Either way, they in some way compared
themselves to Watchmen. They're taking cues from it, right. Well, and the other thing that a lot of people forget is that we'd never really seen a Batman versus Superman before the Dark Knight Returns.
Exactly.
They used to be best friends, and, you know, me being an older school fan, I kind of miss the fact that we don't see their friendship as much anymore. But that was that single comic, that Dark Knight issue 4, where they do have their final scrap, that colored their relationship for the next 30 years.
It would, and both these stories, even though they are completely different on so many levels, at a molecular level, they tell almost the exact same story of what so many comics do, men fighting gods and men prevailing.
Right.
But they do it in complete opposite ways. And that's, to me, what this fight comes down to, where you have Watchmen, where it is humanity almost destroying itself, but finding a common enemy made by humanity to semi-outsmart a god and to prevail in the sneakiest way around everything. And making sure that the world never knows how the gods were defeated. Dark Knight Returns is a complete reverse of head-on wanting to make a show out of everything and showing that not only am I better than the god in the fact that I can outwit you and outbeat you, I will not kill you because I am better.
Right. Are we going to bring in a little bit of outside knowledge in this? I mean,
bring it all in.
One thing, Watchmen, you have to remember, Alan Moore completely and blatantly admits that he stole his ending from an episode of The Outer Limits from when he was a kid.
Yep.
So you've got that versus Frank Miller's arguably more original. Who would win in a fight, Batman or Superman? Yes. Well, clearly Batman, because I like Batman more. Yeah. I'm going to bang my toys together until the satisfactory conclusion comes around.
Very much. And the biggest thing for me that I was racking my head over is once again, these are in the world of comics, these are the sacred texts. These are what no one wants to. This isn't like this is comparing the Quran to the Bible almost in the comics world. In, for lack of a better term,
you are being as inflammatory as possible tonight, man. I love it. I absolutely love it.
I don't care. But what it comes down to me is, as someone who, I guess in certain aspects, I've realized I do prefer endings of a hopeful nature. And for what it comes down to me is, Dark Knight Returns, through the blood, through the guts, through everything, actually had a pretty hopeful outlook where man defeats God, God realizes he's flawed, and at the end of it knows that Batman's still alive, but also knows that he won't tell anyone because he knows what that's for the best.
And see, I think that's a little cynical. I mean, I think Watchmen has a much more optimistic ending than
than
you're pushing for. Yeah, absolutely. I really do think that fat comics nerd guy finding Rorschach's journal at the end of Watchmen is Alan Moore's attempt at a high note. It goes back to your concept of, you know, humanity's banished the god from its midst, which was the problem in the first place. I mean, the whole thing about Watchmen is that Dr. Manhattan so completely skewed world power and that there was no way out with Dr. Manhattan still on planet. So if the happy ending is going to be Dr. Manhattan's gone, but the secret is out, I think ultimately that's a more optimistic ending. Mm-hmm. Not than Dark Knight Returns, but I think it's a more optimistic ending than you're giving it credit for.
I think so much of that ending, though, has always stood on the grand plan of Ozymandias of just doing that on the backs of so many innocent.
Right.
And killing so many in its wake. Mm-hmm. And I think, if anything, people will hate me for this, but we're already here. if we can take any cue from the Nolan trilogy, is that if you build a future on a lie, how quickly and how easily will that lie be broken down and destroy everything you built up?
True. I don't know, though. Personally, if we're comparing the two, and if we have to side one or the other, if that's really what this bout is going to be, there were things that were supposed to happen after Watchmen, and again, I'm pulling in a lot of outside the book knowledge and terminology here, but there were things Watchmen was supposed to represent, and there were things Watchmen was supposed to be that got either misunderstood or misinterpreted, or corporately just, you know, they saw the one thing and not the other. So many people draw the idea that Watchmen is a mature book because, you know, people have sex in it, or they don't have sex because issues.
Yeah.
When really that's not the maturity of the book. The maturity of the book are the themes that it goes through and the stylized nature of it. The Rorschach issue, where the panels are, you know, placed oppositely to create Rorschachs on every single page. The fact that every cover is the first panel of the comic. It's stylistically, technically, it is by far a superior work. I think what we're arguing here, honestly, is technical superiority versus raw emotional power.
I think why this fight is so interesting is, I think at the core of it, that is Miller versus Moore almost entirely.
Right.
Is that it is raw emotion versus
complete technical genius and artistry. You know, a lot of people I know, and admittedly, when I first picked up Dark Knight Returns, I thought Frank Miller's art was ugly as fucking sin. But there's a reason for that. That's how he tells his story. Oh, yeah. And it wouldn't work with, and as we've seen, you know, I love All-Stars Batman because I think it's a fucking train wreck and I love watching the trains collide. But Frank Miller's story doesn't work with Jim Lee artwork.
Oh, no.
Frank Miller's story works with Frank Miller artwork.
Oh, yeah.
Whereas you need someone with the calm technical precision of a Dave Gibbons for Watchmen to work. And I think that's something we kind of touched on yesterday, or not yesterday, but the last podcast we did, when we were talking about Pax Americana, how before Watchmen felt like such a big middle finger to Moore, not just from a, oh, we're going to use your corporate character sense, but from a, we're not even going to try to emulate what you did. Whereas Frank quietly has that same calm clinical detachment to his artwork that can sell a page in the same way that Dave Gibbons could sell a page of Watchmen.
Very true. Yeah.
I had one more anecdote. When I was working at Walden Books, oh God, 13 years ago, a friend of mine who did not read comics told me that he absolutely loved Watchmen, and the biggest reasons he had for loving it was in the first issue when Rorschach's in the bar snapping that dude's fingers and is like, I've just broken this man's index finger who killed Edward Blake. I've just broken his pinky finger, et cetera, et cetera. Every one of those panels is staged head on. You know, it's not the dramatic Kirby Marvel panel of the guy in the foreground screaming in agony and Rorschach standing behind him with, you know, you can see the insane grin on his face, Deadpool style, underneath his mask. It's all very clinical. It's all very forward. It's is Scorsese the director I'm thinking of? So, you know, someone who can really shoot violence with a really detached again, there's that word. You know, that there's the matter of factness of it versus, and again, you know, one of the absolute best scenes in Dark Knight Returns is when Batman kicks the cop and is like, you know, I can think of so many ways that will, you know, disarm with minimal contact, so many ways that'll cripple him. One of them, kick, hurts. And you know, that is a comic book panel. That is Batman kicking the shit out of a cop in his stomach.
I think this alone shows the power of these two books, is the fact of how much you alone and both of us can quote and just go back and forth on exact scenes and exact words of these books. These, I haven't read either in forever, but I can remember almost every panel of it. Just how visceral it is
in your head.
It just etches it out from the thing in the just almost beautiful, grotesque scenes. Again, Batman fighting the head mutant in his operating scene, if you will.
Right, yeah.
It goes back to that same level of just both these men, they know what they do best. Certain things they can do, they do better than anybody else. And when they know that and take advantage of it, it is beautiful in the worst way.
Right, absolutely.
So at the end of the day, for this first little bell, I'll end it with this one. Say a rainy Saturday night, you want to read one of these. Which one do you read first?
I'm going to cop to something here. In my life, I have owned 5 separate, distinct copies of Watchmen. But I have Dark Knight Returns permanently downloaded on my iPad on my Comixology app so I can turn to it whenever I'm bored.
Yep, that's
so. If we're looking at it purely from easy access to readability, for something that I'm like, I'm bored, I want to read something, I'll probably give it to Dark Knight Returns, because Watchmen is a 7-course meal that you really have, that you really want to chew and digest and be prepared for. Whereas Dark Knight, while it's not a feast, it is a satisfying. What's a good food metaphor? It's a satisfying meal.
It very much. It is the
without gorging yourself on the delicate delights of something as intricate as Watchmen.
Watchmen is like going to me. I would put it, Watchmen. Yeah, it is going to a very nice restaurant, 7-course meal. It's amazing. Dark Knight Returns would be like your mom cooking your favorite food and it turns out amazing.
Like that scene in Ratatouille where they make the food critic the Ratatouille, but they make it super special. And anyway, yes. I love that movie.
But yeah. So,
okay, ding, round two. What you got, bud?
Round two. Well, I'm going to say, I think first one, I hate to say this, and I kind of knew it would be pretty much a wash.
Yeah.
There, I will say they both get a point in that one. I wanted to have that conversation because I feel like that we can't talk about them without that. Kind of have to get that out of the way. So round two, now excluding Dark Knight Returns and Watchmen, so we've talked about them. Who do you think has a more prolific or more interesting, diverse body of work? Or not so much diverse, who do you think overall has a more consistent body of work?
Wow, because that's an interesting question the way you changed it just now, because if you want to say consistent, then it's absolutely Frank Miller, because that dude didn't really change up his style at all. Whereas Alan Moore, you know, he went on and did the Tomorrow Stories. He went on and did Promethea. He's done League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. Stuff for Avatar. His body of work is expansive and, you know, it dealt with superheroes, it dealt with magic, it dealt with the supernatural, it dealt with classical themes, whereas Frank Miller is Batman punching a cop.
By consistent, I'm not directly the same work. I mean more so the quality over the years. Pre 2000, who do you think had
I got to push that forward. You got to give me till pre 2005.
2005,
because you've got to take Dark Knight Returns or Dark Knight Strikes Again into consideration, That is actually probably the best case for examining pre and post Frank Miller, because he was working on it when the towers fell. And issue 3 is such a different comic from issue 1 and 2 because he was so profoundly affected by 9/11.
I say pre-2000 because there's another round coming up that deals more with the post 9/11.
Okay. I see what you're saying. So we're going to go ahead and X Dark Knight Strikes Again out of this.
That's right. Very specifically 2000 on, because next round would be going crazy, pre-2000 forward for both, whose work do you think is better? So, but this round alone.
Okay. Even then, though, and this may be my bias showing, I've got to give it to Moore. I think he's done a wider array of things. I think he's explored new and different ideas. Going all the way back to his work with Alan Davis on Captain Britain, you know, reinventing Miracle Man and taking that concept to its logical conclusion, changing Swamp Thing into one of the single best runs of a comic that has ever been published, in my personal opinion. Alan Moore tried to make comics grow up. He really wanted to push the medium forward, and it's not his fault that the medium learned all the wrong lessons from his work.
Now, this is where it might come surprise, even though for whatever reason I do seem partial to Miller, which is very odd because I normally, by everything I'm more right, it seems like that would be more my preference, but because I'm naturally more inclined to occult and to more magical things and to more of the darker side of things. My second biggest love would be noir and that. So it's very hard hitting for me, but I will say body of work, I do agree. More, not only for how many varied, but just how much work he has put out.
Right, yeah. He was a workhorse for a while, and Frank Miller's always kind of been an avant-garde. Yeah. Now, I don't want to turn this into a Frank Miller bashing session. I've got to say, his Daredevil stuff completely revolutionized what superhero comics could be in the 1970s.
Don't worry. I think Miller, in a few rounds coming up, will get a edge up when it comes to that work. But I do actually have to give it to Moore, too, over his entire body work pre-2000. He was not only more varied, more consistent in quality and more diverse, he was willing to try more things to push the limit. Where Miller found what he was good at, and for a long time, he did that amazing.
Exactly, and that's the thing is, yes, he found his niche, but holy shit, that niche. I mean, 6 out of 7 Sin City volumes are fucking gorgeous works of perfection. And 3 of them are some of the best comics you'll ever read, period.
Fuck it. One of my favorite Miller stories and it falls into the Dark Knight Returns style of work, and it is Dave Gibbons, too, that people never talk about anymore, is Martha Washington, Give Me Liberty. It goes under the radar for so many people, and especially Give Me Liberty is such a fun and good ride.
Yeah, and that's absolutely true.
I love that. And but at the same time, you like you said, Moore has given us not saying Moore, but Moore has given us more taste than just one, and he has given us these ideals and ideas that even when they weren't great in his early years, they were still interesting and innovative in a new way.
And I think that's the period on that argument. Yes. Moore has always been more innovative and interesting, even when he was kind of shitting something out. Whereas if Frank Miller's playing for time, if Frank Miller's working for their paycheck, you can tell. And that's not a knock against Frank Miller. Yeah. It's just that is who he is, and that's fine. But, Moore takes this one. Okay.
And now to the follow-up to that one, which kind of goes to your first one. Pre-2000, so from 2001 and forward. Now, for those who don't know, 2001, Frank Miller, September 11th, of course, in America, hit everyone very hard. But Frank Miller, being someone in the public spotlight and someone who very close to New York, who had friends in the tower, who knew people, who knew all around, who had neighbors there, he was hit harder and took it as a very personal insult. And it drove him very feasibly off the deep end, for lack of a better word.
Right.
And then when Moore, I want to say mid, in that time too, but I want to say closer to the mid to late 90s where he kind of started.
Well, Moore worked with Image for a long time and had actually fairly amicable relationships with Jim Lee and, of all people, Rob fucking Liefeld. Yeah. But when Lee sold Wildstorm to DC, and there were some conspiracy theories at the time, even then, that DC made a push for Wildstorm because they wanted to get close to Moore again, he felt kind of betrayed, and after some contracts ended, he ended his working relationship with Wildstorm, and luckily he owned the rights to the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen concept and was able to push that over to
Avatar?
Top Shelf,
okay.
Which is why he's still publishing, he's still putting out League of Extraordinary Gentlemen stuff. Now most of his work, I've noticed, comes through Avatar.
Yeah, definitely.
Honestly, I think a lot of Alan Moore's craziness is basically people won't fucking leave him alone about Watchmen.
True. I think he became more comfortable with himself and what he was willing to do when he came out as a magician, came out of all that. But at the same time, I think drove him crazy was Hollywood. I think seeing his work on the big screen and what as he looked at it, he looked at his work being destroyed and
bastardized, absolutely. Yeah.
I think that's what drove him to where he is, because he did not – when he was writing the stories, never in a million years did he think his stuff would be eventually sold off to become someone else's work. And under their name and being passed off as what he wanted to happen.
Exactly. And that, I think, was the final straw for him, was that so much of it was boosted and promoted on the back of his name.
Yes.
When he very much wanted nothing to do with it. I remember especially V for Vendetta,
yes,
which is actually a solid film and takes a lot of the ideas and themes that he had was playing with in the books and brings them forward to modern times without shitting on the book itself.
Yes.
But that he was like, okay, fine. If you're making a V for Vendetta movie, that's fine. Just take my name off of it. And the initial promo posters were from Alan Moore, the creator, yep, of Watchmen, V for Vendetta. He threw a fucking fit and good on him,
yeah,
because you had one fucking job.
Yeah.
So yeah, his acrimony is,
and well, for people
understandable,
people listening who don't understand, he was so serious about this Watchmen. He not only did not want any cut of the money, any money he made, he gave to different charities and different people.
And didn't he also, like, insist that Dave Gibbons got a larger cut than he did?
Yes.
He's usually really good about, you know, if you're going to do something with my property, give as much of it to the artist as you can.
Yeah.
In fact, that's why he eventually let go of all the Miracle Man stuff, because Mick Anglo is in such dire straits. So he was like, fine, Miracle Man, do whatever. That's Mick Anglo's money. He doesn't make a red cent off of the Marvel reprints of Miracle Man. That's all Mick Anglo money, which, again, good on him.
So yeah, that all sets up for this round, a little bit of backstory for people who may not know. But who has the better current work from 2001 to today? And I want to immediately, it's the biggest red herring, the biggest problem is Miller does not have much work from 2001 to now. He has a decent amount, where Moore actually has quite a bit that he's put out.
Yeah, Moore has been, again, he's kind of a workhorse. Yeah. He's okay with doing the work. And, you know, this kind of goes back to something we were talking about in the last round, is that even when Alan Moore is shitting it out for a paycheck, he just tosses off an idea and write it down. The dude is so clever and clear in his, execution,
yes,
that even his half-assed ideas are still interesting.
Yes.
However, having said that, and I know that's becoming my catchphrase for this program, and I'm okay with that,
Yeah. There's
something about batshit crazy Frank Miller that you kind of want to see where it's going next.
It is a train off the rails that somehow is heading towards a direction still.
Right. Like I said, I kind of love All-Star Batman and Robin because it is the fucked uppiest, shittiest Batman concept imaginable done on the page. Done by two of the guys who have handled Batman best, which is the most hilarious thing about it. Because if you just said, I'm reading Frank Miller Batman, you know, prior to All-Star Batman and Robin, people have been like, fuck yeah, Frank Miller Batman. You know, Jim Lee has some of the best Batman artwork ever, period. There's no argument. But you put them together and you get excrement.
Well, it's just
total toilet paper.
Oh, the All-Star that killed it's never officially been said, but the biggest rumor, of course, that pretty much killed the All-Star line too.
Right. Yeah, it killed it in the crib.
They were supposed to be All-Star Wonder Woman, All-Star Flash, All-Star, and all we
All-Star Teen Titans.
Yes, all we got was All-Star Superman, which is one of the best examples of comics ever.
Period.
And, an All-Star Batman and Robin, which, like you said, is the craziest, weirdest, like, what was going on kind of thing. Yeah, when you look at it on paper, Frank Miller, Jim Lee, Batman and Robin, there's no way it can go wrong.
And it totally did.
Oh, my God.
But here's the thing, though. Every time, and of course it was one of those books that you got maybe an issue a year because of Jim Lee's schedule, and every time that issue a year came out, it was at the top of my read pile because I couldn't wait to see what absolute insanity met my eyes. So I am almost – I kind of want to give this round to Miller just because
– for the simple fact that Miller is so far beyond what he cares if people think of what he does, to the point – okay, we've talked before. We are some of the only people that – we actually quite enjoy Strikes Again for a few reasons that people overlook.
Right.
Like it is not – everyone looks at it as this direct sequel to Returns that it is not.
So, no, it's very much Miller coming at it as a different person. You know, he came at Dark Knight Returns as a 30-year-old who was like, shit, I'm older than Batman. That's not supposed to be right.
Yeah.
He came at Dark Knight Strikes Again as a 50-year-old going, why am I still writing and drawing superhero comics?
And like you said, halfway through.
Pessimism and, I don't know, self-parody, I guess, that permeates the work is fascinating and kind of great.
People forget to look at it as, people don't like it because not only is it not Dark Knight Returns coming back, it is the guy who made Dark Knight Returns basically making fun of Dark Knight Returns.
Right, exactly. This is something, odd tangent, we were talking about at my comic store today because we were talking about Chip Zdarsky getting announced for Howard the Duck and how that was kind of the perfect and yet perfectly safe choice for the character because no one since Steve Gerber has really been able to get a handle on Howard the Duck. And that's because Howard the Duck was the book that self-proclaimed nerds in the 70s loved because it made fun of them, but it poked fun at them in a very gentle, fun way where it was kind of like, yeah, look, I make comics. You know, I'm a nerd too, but haha, we're all nerds.
Yeah.
And super serious, we're not really nerds, don't call us that, that's an epithet. You know, they really hated Howard the Duck. And it's kind of the same thing with Dark Knight Strikes Again. It's Frank Miller kind of pointing at your things from your childhood that you loved and being like, dude, this was kind of stupid.
Yeah.
You know, it was great, we were kids, but we're adults now. Maybe it's time to put the toys in the toy box. And some people really took offense to that.
Now, that being said, there is one work of Miller's that is probably the
the elephant in the room?
Yeah. That is
came out. Have you read Holy Terror?
I have gotten I always almost buy it. I always look through it, and I've read a few pages of it, and I cannot get past it. It is, how do I say it? It is, you can tell, so much anger and hatred from Miller spewing out against certain groups of people in a way that, once again, of him not caring what people think, it is the most evident, and to this day I'm shocked that it was published.
Who actually ended up publishing it? Was it Top Shelf? Or it's one of the indie publishers, because I know none of the big publishers would touch it with a 10-foot pole, even with Miller's name attached to it.
Okay, once again, for people who don't know, Holy Terror was a book that was supposed to be Batman Holy Terror under Miller that was... It wasn't... essentially is a hero just taking every bit of anger and murder and anything out on, we'll put lightly, Islamic radicalist and other people. I'll put it on that.
And when Miller originally started talking about the project, he absolutely said that this was supposed to be propaganda.
Yeah.
That he was doing it in the style of the propaganda films and comics of the 1940s, when, you know, the Japanese and the Nazis were demonized and dehumanized.
Yeah.
And he tried to sell it as, look, it's a stylistic choice. But really, there's some crazy batshit racism going on.
Oh, yeah. It's just that kind of thing. We've come to a point in culture where we look back at those and are horrified.
Mm-hmm.
And it's even when he's trying to sell the novelty of it, it's still kind of like, wait a minute, we may not want that anyway. The reason why that happened in the 40s and 50s.
Right. Yeah, well, you'd like to think that we've grown past that. You know, certain events in certain areas of America right now might show that we're not nearly as far beyond it as we'd like to think. But at least we can kind of, you know, knock it out of our... pop culture literature. Yeah. if you wanted to satirize it or show the flaws in it, sure, but embracing it wholeheartedly and saying, no, look, I'm just doing it the same way they used to as a piece of propaganda, you're right. Maybe that's something we don't want or need anymore.
Did not notice, actually, Legendary Comics put it out.
Okay.
So, and that must have been one of their early, like, big attempts at comics, as far
right.
as...
That had to be a coup for them, yeah.
Yeah, that's – wow. But yeah, also, if we're talking about current work, we do have to bring up the complete reverse of what Moore feels about Hollywood, Miller's involvement with Hollywood, including some major successes, some major failures, but overall, a very interesting turn in him co-directing Sin City.
Directing The Spirit.
Directing The Spirit and co-directing Sin City 2, A Dame to Kill For.
Right.
And – not, and Damon Kilford writing a new original story, but also showing that, for one, he has a decent eye at directing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and again, you know, this is something you and I have talked about, I want to say, on the last podcast.
Yeah.
They're, you know, while they may not be good movies, they are fascinating movies, and they are fun movies to watch. He keeps you visually arrested to the screen.
And especially the first Sin City hits a lot of things, and... We did talk about this last podcast, but so you can go back and check that out if you haven't. But it is the first Sin City, especially influential to where comic movies were going to go at that point.
Right, exactly.
Because of his willingness to not really care and just do whatever, I kind of do want to give it to Miller just because of that fact. Because Moore, he has written some works, like I really enjoyed Fashion Beast, and there were some others that I really enjoyed.
Fashion Beast was surprisingly strong, wasn't it?
It was. But at the same time, they weren't anything that I... kind of almost the reverse of what we talked about their last one, where they're kind of stuff I expected from Moore. Even though he handled them very well and they were intriguing, they didn't shock me that going, oh, this is Alan Moore?
Yeah.
Frank Miller, some of the stuff he comes out, even knowing it's him, it's like, I did not think he would push it that far.
Yes, and that is probably Miller's greatest... attribute, trick, I mean, pick your adjective, but that dude, there is no more envelope. He's already pushed through it. All there is like scraps of paper where an envelope used to be, and he's still going. You know, there you can see him off in the distance.
I want to be honest here. When I wrote that down, I never in a million years thought we would give better current work to Miller.
It does seem strange, but like we said, I think what it really comes down to is Miller keeps surprising us.
Yeah. I will say
Alan Moore keeps doing phenomenal Alan Moore work. Frank Miller has – what the fuck? Every time you pick up some new piece of Frank Miller work, your reaction is going to be on some level, what the fuck am I reading
exactly.
or watching?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's an interesting turn on that one. Okay. This is one that someone else actually – I heard them talking about. I was talking to some friends saying that we may do this idea. What they were talking about is – who was more important to the characters of comics.
Interesting.
Because, and it's a very valid point where they both define all characters. I mean, Miller single-handedly, changed Batman's future forever, right. Changed or actually added meaning to Daredevil and Wolverine in most ways.
Right.
Of course, you have Elektra, you have plenty of creator-owned stuff. And more, I mean, Swamp Thing and what he did to Joker alone is enough right. to...
Also, if you look at Supreme as the Superman analog that Supreme is supposed to be, he set the tone of a Superman comic 10 years before Grant Morrison got to do it in All-Star Superman.
Yeah.
I mean, Supreme Story of the Year is All-Star Superman 10 years before All-Star Superman came out. And as much as I love and appreciate Grant Morrison and All-Star Superman, and I think anybody who listens to this podcast knows how much we both appreciate that man and his works, you gotta give credit to Moore for being like, you know, being offered the job of doing a Superman knockoff and being like, okay, but I'm basically going to grab the reader by the throat and scream, this is how Superman's supposed to be written, asshole.
Yeah. It is very, and this was a question I wrote down because I knew it's a very odd question, but very relevant to these characters because I know we both, when it comes, especially comes to Daredevil, there's only like 3 or 4 writers that have really gotten Daredevil right, and most of that is because of Miller was the first to really, really get that character.
Well, he made him different from Spider-Man.
Yeah, exactly. You know, yes.
DD was a knockoff Spider-Man for years, and everybody who came in and tried to do something with him kind of came at it from that angle. And Miller was the first one to be like, you know, I like ninjas.
Yeah.
Let's put some ninjas in here. That's going to be super cool.
What?
And he took a Spider-Man villain and made him Daredevil's primary arch nemesis, you know, the Kingpin.
And he, he was the, once again, what these two people are known for, he was one of the originals to put characters through living hell and have them somehow survive and come out stronger or at least alive on the other side. And the first big case being Daredevil. I mean, so much of what comics is today is seeing these characters beaten down, broken down. Once again, may not be the best thing for it, but Miller in a lot of ways set that archetype up and set the groundwork for what would be the triumphant hero after being beaten down.
Well, Miller, and then also you could argue Moore did the same thing with Miracle Man and with Swamp Thing.
Very true.
And then also there's a third on that triangle that a lot of people tend to leave off, especially if you're looking from that particular angle, and that is Chris Claremont over on X-Men. You know, Claremont really also pioneered the idea of here is an entire team of heroes who is – they basically just come together in that time in the 1970s. They are students first and foremost, but also a superhero team. And they get the shit kicked out of them so often that whenever they have to do the occasional issue where they play a baseball game and just reflect on how much shit has been kicked out of them.
That's fair. And tying it back in – Claremont and Miller's work with Wolverine.
Right, yes.
It's so true. Once again, these people being so, some people don't look at these two artists and as being similar, yet they have done so much in similar veins for the genre.
Yeah, that's what makes this question kind of difficult because yeah. Moore usually worked on the fringes. You know, he didn't really do a lot of work with specific superhero characters. And the ones he did play with were the, you know, he wrote the Killing Joke, and he wrote Whatever Happened to the Man of Tomorrow, and that Superman annual with Mongul that is one of the best Superman stories ever told. But he didn't really play in those universes all that often or all that much, whereas Frank Miller really gleefully took the reins on a Wolverine, on Daredevil, on Batman. So it's almost an unfair comparison if you're looking at strict characters, but if you're looking at characterization and the growth of characters using the medium, again, I kind of want to go ahead and give this one to Moore because of the character work he did in A Swamp Thing or in Supreme.
That's...
or through his entire body of creator-owned characters that he did in the ABC line. Because, again, you know, Frank Miller had his niche, and his niche was ninjas and
one thing
beating down your superhero to bring them back up.
One thing we haven't really brought up yet that I think very goes in Miller's corner is characters. A lot of times when you know people make a big impact on the character and other writers will come along, kind of change it, kind of mess with it, try to change it. One thing that has not changed is what Miller set up in year one alone has stayed in the Batman universe to this day, pretty much.
True.
And for a character that is that important, being Batman, which has become the flag that DC carries, in a lot of ways, the Batman that's being written today still has connections to that, those issues, that graphic novel, still year one, still holds true to him. And I mean, whereas stuff like it is very hard because you could say similar things like you just said, even to Swamp Thing in some ways to Superman. Like, spent more on Swamp Thing that Moore set up, even though changed by writers, the ideas in that one are still present in almost any Swamp Thing story today.
Right.
Which I don't know why I made that point because I just contradicted what I was trying to do in general.
Like I say, that's what makes the question so complex, because if you're looking purely at character, you kind of have to throw it at Miller because he was more willing to play with the characters that we all love. But if you're looking at characterization, I would have to give a hat tip to Moore because he grew all the characters under his umbrellas and all the various umbrellas that he had.
You know, I didn't think this would be the toughest question, but I do think cause I'm going back and forth on each way because I do agree that I think on the small, very personal level, Moore definitely was more important to each character, where he did change their for however long he was on it, and before him and after him were completely changed because of what he did. And Miller had like a very much an oversight almost of where it was the bigger plan of throughout the years, his presence would still be kind of way in the background.
Right.
Oh, that's a hard one.
Do you want to call this one a wash?
We've already done that once. I think we kind of have to, because I think they are both, honestly, and I can say this, I think they're equally important to the characters, because without them, we wouldn't have, I mean, because Joker, what changed Joker in so many ways were two books, Arkham Asylum and Killing Joke. That kind of set up the Joker that we were talking about with Scott Snyder, the Joker that is this, that turning point of him becoming more of a force of nature.
Right. A concept, idea made flesh as opposed to a character.
Killing Joke kind of set up the idea of him, he's more willing to get across an idea than anything else. See, I mean, the Joker that is in Killing Joke is the one that is in books today. He's not the Joker that will rob a bank just because he needs money. He's not the Joker that he's the Joker that will have this elaborate plan just to show Jim Gordon that even the best of you can be broken down to my level.
Right.
I hate to do it, but I do have to say that one has to be another tie.
So, if I remember correctly, we've got two washes. We've got one in Miller's corner. Yeah. We've got one in Moore's corner, which means your fifth and final question is going to be weighted as hell.
Yes, which we have a possible bonus question that wasn't going to be for points, but it, depending on how this goes, it may.
I hear that, man. I kind of had one I wanted to ask myself, but we'll save mine to the very end.
We'll say this is the last one, the most important point. Everything else can be worth something. I don't know.
Right.
We love both these artists we love. We give them a chance, but which one would you rather see have a successful comeback?
Honestly, and this isn't even something I've got to think about, Alan Moore. Not even something I have to sit and ponder, because he still has so many fresh and new and exciting ideas. He still has so much life in him as a creator that, you know, I would love to see something break for him again. The thing is, now that I say that, though, I don't know. He doesn't want to be involved in the industry anymore. So maybe for his own sake, maybe I should take that back. Because he's kind of, you know, it's not that he's done with comics. He's done with, oh, God, this sounds so insulting. He's done with us.
Now, well,
comics fans let him down.
I'll focus this in the comeback world. I will say, yeah, comics fans, and I wouldn't say so much comic fans as much as, yes, comic fans, but also comic culture.
As yes, yeah.
Comic, because there are still, I think if he believed fans had failed him, he would not still put out books, but I do believe that's why he goes through Avatar, that's why he goes through, purposely goes through smaller, and does more obscure titles, because he doesn't want to be part of the cultural zeitgeist that comics have become. He wants to get to the fans that want to find him.
Right. That's absolutely true.
So, by comeback, I guess I'm more so, which, not so much a comeback as the mainstream loves him, but either one being more so of a 4, 5, 6 issue series that you read and you go, holy crap, this is as good, maybe the world doesn't know about it, but this is as good as anything they've ever done. And
Alan Moore.
I've got to say, once again, I this is not a tough one for me, because I will honestly, I think Moore, this, I would love for Miller to do it too, but I think Moore has, I do think he still has more to say.
Absolutely. I think that's really what it comes down to. Yeah. Moore still has that creative force inside of him.
I think Miller does, but I think it's almost time for him to go. I mean, people might not want to be heroes, but I would like to see an original idea for a movie by him at this point.
Like, that's kind of true. Yeah, actually, I would much rather see Miller explore his Hollywood options and sow those roots. He's clearly having more fun as a director than he's had in comics in years.
Made 2 movies in the time that he's worked. And I mean, I don't know if he's worked on any comic in the course of the past 8 years.
Holy terror. I mean, well, he finally knocked that out. But I mean, yeah, as far as any project that wasn't a passion project of his, when was the last issue of All-Star Batman? And it's kind of weird to say. All-Star Batman was Frank Miller's last significant contribution to comics outside of Holy Terror. That's a weird fucking sentence.
But Holy Terror, in fairness, is also, he worked on that for a long time. He just had to rewrite and change some names and some images at the last second.
And erase some bat ears.
Not so well.
Exactly. That's what I hear, yeah. He forgot the shadows.
So, if that is the and that can definitely be the final round, I think it's a good one. We can get into just some personal stuff we'd like to figure out in a minute, but
yeah,
I do think in a very, very, very close tie where Dark Knight versus Watchmen, a wash, tie, both very important. Both, you cannot necessarily pick which is better, just because that is, it is apples to oranges in the best way of, you cannot define, because that comes down to opinions that between each person, and even that person normally cannot decide between those two.
Exactly. There's a reason they are usually spoken of in the same breath. Yeah. That's what it comes down to.
Body of work, more, better, current work. So the most surprising one on here. But because, like we said, and we talked about last podcast too, with why we like the Dame to Kill For, because even at its worst, it was fun and kept our attention to a point when Moore is at his worst, when it is something that we are reading, and even if it's an interesting idea, Moore has a tendency to where we can get lost in some of that and kind of abandon issues. Miller, I've never abandoned, because I want to see how crazy it goes.
Exactly.
Impact on characters like Dark Knight and Watchmen, they have both been so important. It's very hard to do that. Comeback with the winning KO, Alan Moore.
By technical knockout, yes.
And very close.
Ultimately, as close as this argument was, I don't think that was in any doubt. I think both of us ultimately can admit that Alan Moore is a singular creator. You put him up against anybody, he's probably going to come out on top.
We may find that out in a future fight.
That's true, because we've already discussed one that may put my words to the lie.
To possibly tease a future fight, we talked about this podcast, and for this podcast especially, it would be an interesting fight for how much we seem to favor Morrison.
Right.
But it's a fight that has been talked about that other people have done before, and it's always a very interesting one, because whereas Miller and Moore were very similar but reverse, Moore and Morrison are so similar.
They are parallels.
Yes, they are. They are. If any two people could be put together to make Harvey Dent in Two-Face, it would be Moore and Morrison.
That is a brilliant observation, my friend. Absolutely brilliant.
But so I wanted to, so just some off the cuff, just ran stuff here. Some other questions that I was like, they're not bad, but I didn't even know. One I was wondering, who do you think had the bigger cultural impact over all these years?
Well, again, that kind of gets back to the question of characterization, because, you know, Miller cultivated a presence for himself. You know, he kind of did the Neil Gaiman thing where he had the black jacket and he had the shaggy hair, and he would go to the interviews and he would make cameos in his own movies. I mean, he's the guy with pen in head in the Daredevil movie, of all fucking things. Whereas Alan Moore, even when he was at his best known and at his best love, and before he really became sick and tired of everything, he was always kind of a recluse. So he was better known for his letters, whereas Frank Miller kind of had the pomp and personality behind him. So cultural impact kind of goes back to characterization, in that Alan Moore's is kind of diffuse and kind of goes, you know, percolates in more pots. Frank Miller is in one or two pots, but those pots are boiling over with verve and passion.
One
so.
Thing that I would actually, what I would say the biggest one is, and it's actually because of something that Moore may not be proud of, but because they made a movie based on V for Vendetta, the V character and V facial mask, V's image became synonymous with Anonymous and with all these cultural riot groups and hacktivists and everything, to the point where even though people don't know Moore was behind it, I would almost argue Moore just because now anything that has to do with revolting has V behind it.
True. But I mean, if you want to take it from that angle, Batman is the most popular superhero in the world.
That's what I was about to say, especially with Batman vs. Superman and Batfleck being the Dark Knight of...
He is the Dark Knight Batman. That is the movie version we're getting now. And even Christopher Nolan's version
was very
owed some fealty to both Year One and Dark Knight.
Yeah.
Frank Miller's impact on Batman as a character cannot be overstated.
Oh, no, he is...
It's literally true. You cannot say enough how big of an impact on that character he had. And if that character is the most popular character in the world, you have to lay some of the credit at the feet of Frank Miller for that.
No, I would... And I don't think... Yeah, it's not even arguable. When it comes to Batman, I honestly think Frank Miller at this point in time, he is up there with Bob Kane, with... Oh, my God, I'm slipping his name.
Bill Finger.
Yes. He is
Neil Adams, Jim Aparo.
Yeah, they are in that same room because of how, just how much that people don't even realize that they are the ones that set this character up. That, especially Miller, where the Bob Kane, Bill Finger Batman is not the Batman we're reading today.
Right.
It is much very, 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 very closer to the Frank Miller one. With a lot of other sprinkles in, of course, but...
Of course. Yeah, I mean, if we're going to look at it from that angle, I actually feel like I have to give this one to Miller. Because Batman, most popular character in the world, owes so much of who he is currently to one creator, and that creator is Frank Miller. I think we've argued our way into Frank Miller.
This is why we ended at comeback, because this has been another tie, and...
Yeah.
It shows the power of these two writers, the fact that we can go back and forth, and on ones that we may think may go one way, we can talk ourselves into a different one.
Right.
So what was it? You had a question you were wondering.
It's not really a fully formed question, and you did address it a little bit, because we kind of, in our pre-2000 work, we very much left off the idea that Alan Moore had a take on Batman.
Yeah.
He wrote Batman, he wrote The Killing Joke, which completely, as you said, began the process of redefining the Joker for a new generation.
Mm-hmm.
It was a book that was supposed to be out of continuity, but the response to it was so impressive that it was actually retroactively written into continuity, and Batgirl, who was never supposed to be paralyzed, ended up, you know, in a wheelchair for 20 years.
To the point where...
30 years.
I don't know if this was on our Lost podcast or not, but to the point of... It was supposed to be out of continuity, and the point where there are still a lot of people who believe that Killing Joke ends with Batman killing the Joker.
Right.
And we've talked about it a little before. It's hard, those final panels especially, are kind of hard to deduct because it could be simple. It could be a very simple, like, okay, well, we didn't think they would look at this panel like that.
Right.
But it's also from Alan Moore, who's someone that goes, of course someone's going to look at the panel like that.
Right.
And it's for people who don't know, it's basically because the silhouettes and Joker's laughing changes dramatically.
Right.
Which sounds small.
At one point, it looks like the Batman is either what I've always thought, which is apprehending the Joker, you know, reaching out to grab him so that he can go ahead and get him apprehended, or strangling him.
Yes.
One of the two, and it is left intentionally vague. The Joker's laughter does cease suddenly.
Yep. And we are left with Batman, after a crazy joke, Batman laughing for one of the awkwardest and creepiest laughs in a comic ever.
Yes, exactly. So, like I say, it's not really a fully formed question, but Killing Joke as an impactful Batman story, not necessarily versus Dark Knight, because I think clearly Dark Knight's the winner if you're going to go in a straight versus, but, you know, Alan Moore clearly had an impact on the Batman universe as well. I really don't have a question for that. I was just kind of thinking we should talk about Killing Joke a little bit more in the context of both of these creators' handling of that one character.
I've always preferred Alan Moore's handling of Joker because it goes along more with the version of the Joker that I prefer, which is the force of nature, the man built on ideas, where Frank Miller's Joker, because of when it was made and the book that it's made in, it still has some elements of that old Joker in it. Even though it is much more the idea of like the comatose Joker that is just waiting for the day the Bat comes back.
Right.
Just the character portrayal has very, very small elements, but it still has that force of nature feel to it. So I would say for the Joker character, I think Killing Joke was more important.
I agree. What really strikes me about Dark Knight Returns is Miller kind of played on the whole Wortham idea of Batman's potential homosexuality, not with Robin, because he in fact gives him, you know, Carrie Kelly, a female Robin, but that there's very much homosexual, homoerotic subtext and imagery in his relationship with the Joker. The Joker constantly calling Batman darling. Mm. The line, you know, "we tumble like lovers" is how Batman describes tackling the Joker. There's very much an intimate relationship within the subtext of that book that actually that's what Morrison picked up on.
Oh yeah.
For his Arkham Asylum, which we also talked about having such an impact on the Joker as a force of nature. So in a way, you're absolutely right. He is Miller was definitely dealing with Joker as human with elements of force of nature within it, whereas Killing Joke very much starts the ball rolling on the Joker as, like I like to refer to him, concept made flesh. Yeah. He is a conception of anti-Batman, basically.
And for what people may hate or not, it also gave what most would say the only version of Joker's origin – or lack thereof, or of course the famous line, "If I'm going to have an origin, it may as well be multiple choice."
Multiple choice, yeah.
Which is something I've always stuck by wholeheartedly when it comes to the Joker. We didn't even talk about something that I'm surprised at, and I just looking at my bookshelf realized did not talk about. Moore made a character that's one of both of our favorites, the creation of Constantine.
Right, that's true. Constantine was introduced in the pages of Swamp Thing, very much based on Sting of the Police in visuals, and gave the character his basic personality. Basically, he wanted to come up with play with the idea of a blue collar magician and the idea of a working class supernatural character, very much in Thatcher's Britain at the time. Yeah. So,
and that alone, cultural impact and character impact. Not only do we have the Constantine show going on right now, which there's some weird stuff there because I guess production on the show ended as of episode 13 and they're not 100% sure if it'll be renewed for season 2, but it's still possibly there.
Right. The thing is, a lot of shows do now is they order an initial 13 episode commitment. If the show proves a hit, they'll push it to 24. Like Flash, one of the things that people were like, "Holy shit!" about it was that after the pilot or the first episode following the pilot, it got a full 24 episode commitment, and everybody was like, "That's unprecedented. That's insane." And then Constantine, 4 or 5 episodes in, they did not push for a full 24 episode commitment. But that they're not, you know, discounting the idea of a second season at all. They just don't feel the need to have a full 24 episode season.
It does bug me because it is on Fridays, which is I mean, notorious for, you're going to get weird ratings on Fridays because that is so dependent on everything from the weather in certain towns and areas to the holidays to shows. But back,
it's the Friday night death squad. It got screwed on time for sure.
Back on track. So many shows have taken the Constantine character and just put them in a show, renaming him.
Yes, I remember when I was watching. I remember watching Supernatural for the first time, and when Castiel was first introduced, I busted out laughing because I was like, "Holy shit! They put a John Constantine in their show."
Yeah, and especially that show in particular, not even hiding it remotely, and even at points, semi joking about it.
Right. Exactly.
But yeah, that alone, that character put so much shoe in. At the end of the day, we may have picked more as a winner, but even looking at my bookshelf, just seeing the books that stand out and seeing how much of them are Miller and Moore really speaks volumes for them.
Right. Another one we didn't talk about at all, which is one of my personal favorites, is Frank Miller's Ronin, which is a flawed work. It is not perfect by any means, but you can definitely see him connecting a lot of the dots that he wants to play with in the future. So it's proto Miller in a really fascinating way, and I kind of love it for that.
It's one of his more, even though we do know of his love of ninjas and samurai, it's still him taking a bigger risk than usual when it comes to a big Marvel property on that.
Right.
So, I think that actually kind of wraps up this first episode semi-nicely.
Yeah, and it ran way longer than we were thinking it was going to. That's kind of fantastic.
I'll definitely say, give the lovely people our email really quick.
All right. If you want to contact us, our email is blahblahpodcast@gmail.com. If you want to talk to me personally and tell me I'm wrong and Frank Miller's amazing and Alan Moore sucks, that you can do that @VoodooBen on Twitter.
Or me @HellhoundF5. But I was saying email because I want to see what if people – really, if you like this, hear this anywhere, disagree, agree, whatever, send us something and send us what you want – what fight you want to see next because we've talked about – Moore versus Morrison, which will happen eventually, but
I would be more than happy to do a comics collision based on any two creators that you guys want to hear us talk about.
I want to say one that popped in my head today, which would not be fair at all, but it would because it would pit us against each other. The only one I think is off the limits for right now is probably Gerard Way versus Warren Ellis. Because I feel like that would actually negatively affect our friendship at that point.
It potentially could, absolutely. And yeah, there's no way we would be able to come to a consensus on pretty much anything.
Yeah, I was about to say, just for or Umbrella Academy versus Transmetropolitan, don't put those. Those are the only two that I will say are off limits because it will just be us arguing and bickering back and forth for like 5 hours about, no, this is better, no, this is better.
Right, yeah, it wouldn't be the fun kind of argument bickering that I know at least a few of you thought, hey, I actually kind of want to hear that. Yeah. No, it would be just you know, unintelligible screaming at each other after a certain point.
It would just be no, because Vanya, no, because Israel, no, because, and but or even, not just only the writers or artists, but caregivers, characters, if anything, I know there's obvious forces like Thanos versus Darkseid, there's bigger ones, it's more obscure ones, but if it's interesting, we will probably do it.
Absolutely. Please hit us up. We would love to hear from you.
Hell yeah. Well, I think this kind of concludes this issue. This should be on Podomatic, probably iTunes, and if there's a good chance, I'm going to try to put this on YouTube too. So if you're hearing it on YouTube, like and subscribe or do something to where we know you're hearing it there because I want to test it out because it is so. Almost a one shot of our podcast. It can do very well by itself, I think.
Absolutely. So I'm looking forward to that data as well.
So for now, thank you guys for giving us a chance.
Absolutely. Thanks for listening.
Bye.
Bye.